Okay, hello and welcome back. I hope you have seen the two videos of mine on this chapter, that is economy and its entity. And in this video, we will continue with some more topics. So let me start with the chapter and quickly see what are the things we have done so that we can continue with some more topics. I hope you remember. We have first tried to understand what is the general definition of the word economy, and then we have also gone to two more definitions, that is economy can be defined as a system of cooperation and system of mutual exchange. Just after this, we have seen what is the meaning of the word economic entity and what does entity means. I told you that according to the entity, peoples can be classified under the heading of consumer or household, firms and government. Then we have seen the relationship between the three entities, that is household, government and businesses. So we have also seen who are called consumers and the functions of consumer, household and the importance of household in the economy, right? Then who are called producers, classifications of producer as a primary, secondary and tertiary producer. Examples, you have seen that examples of the primary producers are farmer and fishermen, whereas secondary are the bakers and the weavers, and the tertiaries are the people, those who are involved in a service sector, like the people, those who are involved in a banking, insurance and sector, like examples are doctor, car cleaner, teachers, etc. So you remember everything. Then we have seen the importance and the role of the producer or the firm in the economy. Who are called government, what is the role of the government. I told that in order to understand the role of the government, we have to understand under two heading. One is called direct role and the second is called indirect role, right? So this was the last slide that we have gone through in the second video, where we were trying to understand what are the direct role of the government in the economy. And I told you that according to the direct role, that is the role which the government played directly into the economy, we have seen 3 points and we have discussed that how they are called as a direct role of the government, where you have seen that one of the direct role of the government is development of basic infrastructure. For any economy to grow, the basic infrastructure is a compulsory. Like for example, transportation is an example of a basic infrastructure. Electricity generation, that we are calling power, is again one of the basic infrastructure. So basic infrastructure is something that we need very much for the growth or development and economy, and the government take this responsibility initially, and thereafter we see that the private sectors also take this responsibility after some point of time. Then we have seen the another important role that the government play in the economy is the removal of inequalities of income. I hope you remember I told removing the difference between rich and poor, and there are many ways by which the government is trying to remove the difference, that is the difference between the rich and the poor, through a progressive tax system. I use this word progressive tax system, and I told progressive tax system is a system where the poor people are taxed less and the rich people are taxed more because their ability to pay taxes more. So that is why progressive tax system is being used to remove the inequalities of income. Then there are some programs which the government run to remove the inequalities, like MNREGA, we have discussed, midday meal scheme, Atal Pension Yojana. So like this, we have discussed many programs that is helpful to that is run by the government to remove the inequalities. And then we have also seen the third direct role of the government, that is it direct the market forces. As I told that sometime it happened that due to the market condition of demand and supply, the price of the commodity is very high and the poor people cannot afford those commodity or goods. So in that respect, the government step into the economy. They, with the help of the public distribution system or what we have called ration shop, so through that shop they provide the goods at a subsidized price to the people who belongs to the BPL category. So that is a few these are the few important direct role that the government play in the economy. So if you look into the next slide, then you're going to find three more direct role that is played by the government in the economy. And out of that, one of the important role is industrial development. As I told, the government play the role of both consumer as well as producer. So it is not that the government only look after the law and order or peace in the economy, but it also involved themselves in an economy like India, because India is an example of a mixed economy where both private sector as well as the public sector work together hand in hand. So the government here also play an important role by producing goods and services for us. And in that respect, there are some industries in which the government play a major role. Like for example, if I give some examples, then you can see here iron and steel industry, heavy electrical industry, fertilizer industry, chemical industries, and so on. So there are many industries that form the basic of any economy. So iron and steel is a very important industry, and as we know, the government play a very important role in the production of iron and steel. So somewhere or other, we can say that the government is playing its role in developing the industries of our economy. And basically, these industry like iron and steel industry, electrical industries, fertilizer industry, so these industries do not, or I may say, need a lot of investment. And at the same time, their profit period is very long. So after a long period of time, the firm can make a profit. So such type of investment or such a long profit period is not actually welcomed by the private sector. So we see that the private sector do not take much interest in production of those goods and services that require huge investment or that have a long profit period. So that is the reason that why the private sector do not take interest in that. But as we know that these industries are very important for the development of any economy, so the government step into it and the government take the responsibility. So somewhere or other, we say that the government has one of a very important direct role to play in the economy, is to help the industrial development. So this is what actually one of the direct role that we can talk about, right? Similarly, you know, that is agriculture is one of the most important sector of our economy. And why we say that for an economy like India, agriculture is a very important part of our economy, because we see that the statistics and the data tell that around 47%, you can see here it is written 49%, but the present data tell that around 47% of the working population of our country is enrolled in an agricultural sector. So that shows the importance of the agriculture sector in our economy. So we can say that almost half of the working population, that means the number of the people who are available for work, out of them, half of the working population are working in an agricultural sector. And so it become very important for a government to form policies or to frame policies so that majority of the people in our economy does not get affected due to one reason or other, or due to some policies or other that is constructed by the government. So as you can see here, it is written, for a country like India, where 49% of the working population are enrolled in agriculture sector, agriculture need proper planning. So this is what I was trying to point out. So the government try in all respects so that they can frame such policy such that they can help the agriculture sector at most. Because the government know very well that majority of our population is enrolled in an agriculture. So if something bad happened to that, then the entire population is going to get affected because of this. And as you know, that agriculture is the basic of the industries that we have in our country like India are more or less the maximum industries are agro-based industries. So they use agricultural good as their raw material. So if something happened, if something bad happened to the agriculture sector, then definitely the effect will also be there on a secondary sector, that is industrial sector, and the tertiary sector also. So that is the reason that why the government has an important role to play for agriculture development. And let's see what are the ways by which the government protect or help to develop the agriculture sector. You can see here the government take proper step to ensure increased fertilizers. So you know, fertilizer is one of the basic input for agriculture sector. So production of fertilizer so that the more number of industry can be set up such that they produce more fertilizers for the farmer, and the farmer can use those fertilizer and can buy the fertilizer at a least price from the market. So the government look after this carefully. Similarly, irrigation facility, you know that in a country like us, that is in a country like India, still we say that agriculture is a monsoon dependent. So Therefore, the government is trying its level best so that we should not depend on monsoon for good cultivation. So we can have a irrigation facility, that is the storage of the water. From there, the farmer can use this water for watering, right? So that is what irrigation facilities, availability of water for farming. Then the government has also made some arrangement like cold storage facility, such that so that the farmers can store their agricultural good in a proper way, or I may say for a long period of time, so that when the price of the commodity rises, they can take the advantage of the market situation. And of course, one more we can see here, that is crop insurance. So these are nothing, but these are the way by which the government support the agricultural sector of our economy, and one way or other help in the agriculture development. So this is how the government play its role in helping the agricultural sector in our economy, right? And as we know, finally, if we come on to the third point, then you can see here, maintenance of law and order. Yes, we can see this, that another important role of the government is to maintain law and order in the country. So if law and order is not good, then we find that the investor from outside the country may not be interested to invest the money in our economy. So any big investor from outside the country will be interested to invest in the country only when there is a stability in the economy. Stability means there is a proper law and order in the economy. So if there is a proper law and order in the economy, the investor feels secured with respect to their investment, and hence they invest a lot of money. And this investment, that is the outside investment in our economy, brings lot of development in forms of increased employment and in forms of increased production in our economy. So that shows that somewhere or other, one of the important role of the government is to maintain law and order in the economy, so that the people we can run the economy in a smooth manner. So these are the three more direct role that we can talk about. So there are many things that we could have discussed, but due to the limitation of time, we cannot talk too much on the topic. So this is what actually we have here. So I told 6 points on the direct role. One is called development of basic infrastructure, removal of inequalities of income, indirect market forces, industrial development, agriculture development, and maintenance of law and order. Hope you remember I told that in order to understand the role of the government, we have to understand this in under two category. One is direct role, and the second is what we call indirect role. So other than the direct role, what we have some more role that the government play in the economy, and that can be categorized under a heading of indirect role. Look at here, under indirect role, one of the major role that the government has to play is to maintain economic stability. We are talking about here economic stability. And economic stability is nothing, but economic stability means that the government must play its role in such a manner so that there is neither a situation of inflation nor there is a situation of deflation in the economy. See, the word I have mentioned here, inflation and deflation. So you may be wondering what is inflation and what is deflation is. So in short, I'll try so that I can make you understand what is inflation and deflation, and then you will be in a better position to understand this point. So first, let us understand what is inflation and deflation is. So inflation is nothing but we define inflation like this, that inflation is a consistent or persistent rise in general price level, whereas deflation is defined as persistent fall in general price level. The word general price means average price, right? So let us take example like this. Suppose let us take 5 commodities. Imagine that in the economy there are 5 commodities are produced, and the prices of those commodities are given. Let us take the price as 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the first commodity, the price is 1. Second commodity, the price is 2. Third commodity, the price is 3. Fourth commodity, the price is 4. And the fifth commodity, the price is 5. What does it shows? Now in order to find out the average price, what we do, we add up. we add all the price and then divide by the number of the commodities. So if I'm going to add, then 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. So let us add and find out what is this. So 1 plus 2 3 3 plus 6 6 plus 4 10 and 10 plus 5 15. So what we are getting, the sum total as 15. And how many commodities are there? There are 5 commodities. So I'm going to divide. So 15 divided by 5, that is equals to 3. So I'll say the average price is 3. Now the point is, suppose if in the next year, the price of 4 of the commodity remains same, but the last commodity, the price increased to say 7. So earlier it was 5, now it is 7. So 5 plus 7, so 15. So therefore, that if you add up, then you're going to find earlier it was 15. So now 15 plus 2, 17. So 17 divided by 5, definitely you're going to get it more than 3. So that shows that average price is rising. So it, yes, of course, this is not only the condition that the price of only one good may rise. So it may happen that some of the goods, the price of some good is rising, whereas the price of some goods fall. But if the average price, if after the calculation we are getting that the average price has increased, then that is a situation of inflation if it continues year after year. I'm using the word persistent increase in the average price. Okay, so and on the other hand, if suppose if the average price continue to fall year after year, then that is a situation of deflation. The point is, neither inflation nor deflation is a good situation for an economy. Just a small example. So inflation implies that the price is rising and we have to have more money to buy the commodity. So inflation is not good from the point of view of a consumer. So no consumers will be happy if they have to pay more money for the same commodity that they are purchasing. Similarly, deflation is not good from the producer side. So if the price of the commodity will continue to fall, then what will happen? The producer may be demotivated and they are going to stop the production of the good because they may find the situations or the economy is not in their favor. So that is what. So the government has to play its role in maintaining the stability between inflation and deflation. That means there should not be rise in the price, there should not be fall in the average price. So that is what we are talking in this point. Yes, of course, I can understand that since we are going through these video, so in case you are still having any doubt with the topic of inflation and deflation and you cannot understand what is inflation and deflation, of course, when we are going to meet in the class, I'll make you understand in much easier way what is inflation and deflation by giving some more examples. Okay, so for time being, you just understand that inflation is nothing but it is continuous rise in price, and deflation is nothing but it is continuous fall in price. So how government maintain economic stability? How government avoid inflation and deflation? The government can avoid inflation and deflation in the economy by using two policy. One is called monetary policy and the other is called fiscal policy. Monetary policy is such that affect the amount of money or the quantity of money that we people have. So the question is, why we demand more? Why we demand more? We will demand more only when we have more money in our pocket. So when we have more money in our pocket, we demand more in the market. And that is where there is a chance of inflation to take place. So if demand and supply is equal, then there will be no inflation. But suppose if there is a more demand and less supply, then the chance of inflation comes. And this type of inflation is called demand pull inflation. That is caused by increase of demand. The point is, suppose if I give you one example, imagine that there is 2 pen available in the market and 3 of you went to a market to buy the pen. Now the question is, who is the one who is not going to get the pen? So the one who is not going to give the highest price is not going to get the pen. Or you may take the example like this, that there is only 1 pen in the market and 2 of you went to the market to buy the pen. The question is, who will get the price? Who will get the pen? The one who is going to pay the highest price is going to get the pen. So therefore, the one person is there who will be unable to get the commodity. It's only because the price of the pen has increased. And the one who is a rich person, he is paying the price and so he is getting the pen. And the one who is poor, he is not getting the pen because he cannot afford it. So that situation is definitely not good for the economy. This is actually what I'm trying to explain, that how, so therefore, the one way which the government can try to control inflation is to reduce the money with the person who is having more money with them. So if the government can reduce the amount of money with that person who is having more money, then somewhere or other the equality can be brought in the economy. So okay, for time being you just understand this, that monetary policy is nothing but it is a type of a policy where the government use some of its technique like bank rate, open market operation, cash reserve ratio, etc. So these are the some of the monetary policy which the that is the government use to control inflation and deflation in the economy. So this is actually how the government can bring monetary economic stability. Similarly, there are one more policy that the government has called fiscal policy. And here what government do, the government use the technique or the tool of taxation, public expenditure, public borrowing and deficit financing. So these are the four fiscal policy that the government use in such a manner so that they can control the situation of inflation as well as situation of deflation. One example, suppose there is a commodity available in the market and a person is there who is having a lot of money with him. So if the government want to control the purchasing by him so that he do not buy all the commodities and the other people will not get the commodity, what the government can do, the government can impose more tax on him. So if the tax is imposed on him, then the amount of money that he is left to spend is definitely going to reduce. So when the money in his pocket is going to reduce because he has to pay the tax to the government, so he is not going to demand too much in the economy. And hence, the government can reduce the demand in the economy and can bring it to equals to supply. So that is the way, this is one very small example that I am taking just to make you understand that how this monetary and the fiscal policy is working, because these two topics, that is monetary and policy and fiscal policy, is a vast topic and have a lot of things, but of course it is not there in your syllabus. It is just a small introduction of monetary and fiscal policy that you have in your syllabus, and therefore I'm trying my level best so that I can make you understand what is monetary policy and fiscal policy by giving some small examples so that you can understand that how the government uses these two policy to control economic stability, right? Hope you are getting my point. So we can make a conclusion. So let us make the conclusion. So the conclusion is only this, that the government has one very important indirect role in the economy is to maintain stability. That means the government never wants the price to rise, never want the price to fall. And this rise in price and fall in price can be controlled by the government by using two type of policy. One is called monetary policy and the other is called fiscal policy. So that is what actually the point is. And coming on to the final, that is the last slide. As you can see here, another important role that the government play in the economy is to regarding the trade. Yes, what is trade? Trade is nothing but the export and import. You know that we export the commodities from our country and as a result we earn foreign currency from them, and sometime we import the good from outside the country to our country, and we have to give the foreign currency to them, or that is what. So simply the point is, one of the indirect role of the government is to maintain the foreign trade, or is to formulate the foreign trade policy so that the economy does not find the problem of BOP, balance of payment. You see here, there is a word called balance of payment. I'll try so that I can make you understand what is BOP is. See, one thing that I want to bring here with an example so that you can understand that how the government use the trade policy to deal with the problem of BOP. So first you have to understand what is problem of BOP. So balance of payment is nothing but, in short, the balance of payment is export minus import. So when we export the commodity to outside the country, we get foreign currency from them, right? And when we import the good from other country, we have to give the foreign currency. So the foreign currency go from us. So when we are exporting, the foreign currency is coming. When we are importing, the foreign currency is going from us. So the point is that sometime the situation come where it happened like this, that we have exported good and we have got, say, $100 from outside the country for exporting the good. And we have imported the good and we have to pay $120 outside country. So what is that? We are getting 100, but we have to pay $120. So we are in a deficit. There is a deficit of $20 to us. So we don't have the $20. This is actually called problem of BOP, balance of payment, because our export is bringing less to us and import is taking more from us. So that is what a problem. So this, I suppose that if this happened to you, then you will say that you are also in a problem. Suppose you have 100 rupees in your pocket, but you have to pay 120 rupees. So now you are in a deficit of 20 rupees. Now the question is how you're going to meet this deficit of 20. Definitely you are going to borrow from your parents. But of course, here the government cannot do this. What government do? The government takes some measure so that they can deal with this problem of BOPO. And what is that trade policy that the government take? The government uses the trade policy like export measure or import substitution, right? Let me come to this point, import substitution. One way to deal with this problem is to reduce the import. So if I can reduce the import, then I can cover up, or I will not fall into the problem of BOP. What I'm trying to say, suppose, as I was giving you one example, that I exported, I got $100. And when I'm importing, the money that I have to pay is $120. So let us reduce the import so that I have to only pay $80. Then we are going to left with $20 more. But the point is, so if we are going to reduce the import, then how I'm going to meet the demand that is produced in our economy? That can be done by import substitution. That means instead of importing from outside the country, let us start produce the good in our own country. Yes or no? That can be one of the way. So that can be one of the way by which we can efficiently deal with the problem of balance of payment. So if we are going to import, we don't have to pay more. That is called import substitution. So instead of importing luxurious car from outside the country, if our auto sector start producing those luxurious car, then definitely we are going to find that our import will be reduced and we can save a lot of foreign currency with us. So that is one of the way how we can control the problem of balance of payment. There is another technique you can see here that is called quota. Quota is nothing but quota is a restriction. Quota is a restriction that is put by the government on the import of the good. So when the importers of our country import the good, sometime when the government find the situation of BOP can arise, they impose restriction. They impose restriction in such a manner so that the import of the good is going to reduce. And if the import of the good is reduced, then we are not going to have a problem of BOP. We will be in a surplus situation. So that is what one of the way again by which the government use its trade. This is a trade policy. This is a type of a policy that the government sometime take in the economy to control the problem of BOP. So I hope you have got some idea. Of course, I will not say that you have get 100% idea about this, but at least you have got some idea that how the trade policy is used to deal with the problem of BOP. So BOP is nothing but actually it is a deficit in the foreign currency of our country. So in the reserve, if we have a deficit, then that creates the problem. So that is what. So we have seen some points today. So today we have seen like this. Today we have gone through three direct role of the government. Then we have seen what is the indirect role of the government, where economic stability we have discussed, and the monetary and the fiscal policy that the government used to control economic stability, and the foreign trade policy that we have seen, right? So, okay, thank you. So we'll continue further with some more videos.